I was born in Verrocker, Wisconsin. Ninth child, born to Elmer and Anna Peterson. And when I was 6 months old, they went and told my dad I had died because I had the whooping cough. And that was whooping cough at 6 months, is what was pretty serious. In 34, my mom had a birthday party for my dad. His birthday was the 7th of October. I think he turned 49 that day. And then she ended up in the hospital, and she was due to come home the next day. And evidently she had a blood clot, and it killed her. And left a family of 10 kids. Of course, my older brother, he did a wonderful job. I was always going to put in the broadcaster. When my mother died in 34, Lloyd was the big brother who did it all. With 9 younger brothers and sisters to care, he always cared. He was always there. There were times were hard and we were poor. We stayed together through it all. Though many years have come and gone since you passed away, our memories of you as strong today as you were that yesterday. Lloyd, we still miss you and think of you often. Palmer, Melvin, Alice, and Olene. Well, he died in 72. Yeah, that was a sad story too. There's a lot of sad stories when you get old.
Did you ever see a robin weep when leaves began to die? Like me, he's lost the will to live. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
And 1 year, my brother and I, we husked 40 acres of corn by hand. You know how much that is? We started, I think, about the 7th of October, and we got done about the 29th of November. And that morning, it was 2 above. We husked 4 loads a day. You had horses, and then you had a double bog, but you had a bang board, because all you had to do was flip it and go in the box. We pick 4 loads a day and 6 days a week. I still got my husband then. It's got to be close to 100 years old. It fitted over here, and then you could peel the husk off this way and then grab the other husk and then flip it and then flip it into the box. But we got pretty good at it. I took a physical when I was 18 years old. I didn't have to go in the service, and we had to go to Chicago. We took a physical there, and I was interviewed by the commanding officer there. And he said, Peterson, he said, just an 8th grade education. I said, yes, sir. And you couldn't know, he said, but you scored higher than most all the high school graduates. What a hell of a compliment. We went to Sag City School in Asbury. I always had the highest average of any of the students there. I don't know, I never took it seriously. I always wished I could have went to high school. Back then they had boxing and stuff, I could have been a good boxer. The only time I ever had a fight was when I had somebody from, there was a bully from beating up somebody. And Palmer, he got, because he was a little shit sometimes. So this big guy, Leroy Hansen, he's 6 foot tall or something. Well, he had a bicycle, and Palmer threw a stick into his spokes of me, and I was broken, so he jumped off of there, and he was going to beat Palmer up. Well, I jumped up and hit him in the nose, and he took off crying like a baby. I had to protect Palmer, that's all. So finally, I went up to the draft board. Oh, they said, you're leaving Friday for the Army. So, and I took basic training in Camp Chaffee, Arkansas. Basic training was a piece of cake for us, like I said, for us farm boys. So we had guard duty that night. So they were gonna go for Business Sharpie's guard. So I thought, well, what the heck, I ain't got nothing to do either. So I get about halfway done, and they said, Dan Peterson, you'll get it. And you know why I got it? One of the reasons I got it was when you snap your rifle and come around, and then he asked me, my first general orders. I said, sir, my first general order is to take charge of disposal and all government property in view. He said, that Peterson seems pretty sharp. He got it. I was supposed to go to leadership school, and I didn't. It was like starting basic training all over again. And all my buddies quit it, so I quit it too. So then the major general there, he said, you guys, you know, you're all going to end up in Korea. We did, but I think he didn't do. I left for overseas on the 1st of October, and we landed in Yokohama on the 1st of November, which was my birthday. And then I was called to go to Dead. They were short of cook schools, cooks in Korea. So they started to set up a cook school in Tokyo. Well, nobody passed up a chance to stay in Tokyo for 2 months. So I went to cook school there for 2 months. And then from there, we took a, when we got done, took a train from Tokyo, went all the way to Sasebo. Sasebo is way down at the, it was an awful long train ride. And then we went through Hiroshima. That was the city that had been hit by the atomic bomb, and you can still see some of the effects from that. But then we took it, it was just from Sasebo to Busan. It was only like an overnight journey. But we took a train and headed north, and there was a bitter cold, it was about the 7th of January or so, and some of the windows had been shot out, and the one time I guess I wish I was back home again. We got up to above Seoul to the 3rd Infantry, and they called my buddy's name to come to report to the mess hall. He said, I'm not going. He said, it's just KP. They called my name. Well, even if it was KP, I went down there and they wanted me to stay there and be a cook. I said, well, I didn't know if I wanted to be a cook. Sergeant said, you're a darn fool if you don't take this job. And you know, the guy that turned it down, he ended up getting killed over there. People said, well, you had it made. I said, no. And you're cooking outside in the tent. How would you like to cook outside in the tent outside and feed up? One time we fed 2,000 men, but usually it was 200, 700, 800, 900. And all the foods we handled, the only thing that wasn't frozen was the canned goods. You work with all this frozen food, and your arm is starting to ache, and I ended up having, I couldn't sleep, my back hurts so bad, and so I ended up going to the medics. Well, they kind of, if you complain about your back, and they kind of smiled at you. Well, one morning, my foot is swelled up, so I went back to the medics, and he was going to send me back my outfit. I said, sir, would you look at my foot? He looked at my foot, he said, I will admit you to the hospital. And I spent the next 100 days in the hospital. I got to see quite a bit of the world anyway. And I even learned some Korean. And I know guys that spent 18 months in Korea, never learned one word of Korean. I could say, Eddie Azameka, that means good morning. And Taizobo, that's lot. And Skoji, that's a little. And Halatu, Satne, Yazo, that's the counting. I used to be able to count quite a ways in Korean. I would have loved to went back sometime, but it's too late now. I went before a physical evaluation board, and I got a medical discharge. And then I got on the bus, and driving my bus is pretty darn slow. And I had never used a phone before I went there, because we never had a phone. But if you never called anybody, you didn't know anybody's number. In Japan, I could have called home. And I could have called home when I got discharged. But, so I took a bus. I got home Christmas Day night. I said, Pa's milking cows. And I said, it was nice to be home. There's no place like home. I could have went back on the farm, but I didn't. Then I worked for different people. And then I met my future wife, and we ended up getting married. And I worked at Oscar Myers, but then got laid off. Well, then my brother, he found a farm that I could rent. So I ended up going back to farming. And If not, I'd have saved us the buyers. I might, in the long run, I might have been better off. But then we farmed for, I don't know how many years, 15, 18 years. And then we had a solar farm, we had an auction, and moved to Janesville and started all over again. I was lucky. I think my job at Parker was one of the best jobs I could ever have had. And I wouldn't have traded it. I could have worked at the plant, but I wouldn't trade my job at Parker. Of course, here you were involved with so many activities. It was just great. I spent, I think, 22 years there, 23.
The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held you in my arms. When I awoke, dear, I was mistaken, so I hung my head and cried. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. Yes, folks, I want to tell you something, tell you for sure. You know there's not much that that old sunshine won't cure. So when you're down and you're feeling kind of low, just step right out in its golden glow. Try not to worry and don't ever whine. Yes, some of good friends and neighbors, all you got to do is just take a little bit, just a spoonful, that good old-timey sunshine. One more time. I'll always love you and make you happy if you will only say the same. But if you leave me to love another, you'll regret it all someday. Sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.